Joe McElderry won the X Factor, but that's not what got everyone talking.
They're not entirely human.
They were like cartoons. Kids loved them.
Even if you think they're annoying, you like them.
Who on earth could they be talking about?
Jedward.
Ah! I'm John. I'm Edward. And together we are John and Edward.
They are just so funny, the way they talk, the way that they are. Obviously, the massive hair.
We're 17 and we're from Dublin.
Where do you see yourselves in 15 years from now?
Well, I see myself being older.
Jedward live in this bubble of, yeah, man, everything's cool, man. And everyone watching knows that they're just these little boys from Ireland who seem to have been grown in some sort of pods away from civilization.
All the loneliness has always been a friend of mine. I'm leaving my life in your hands.
Jedward came along and it was like, oh, you know we're not the best of singers, but we're going to have a laugh with it. And I think that was what was endearing to the general public.
I think it's cheeky more than cocky.
It's not cheeky. It's annoying.
No, it's definitely cocky.
It's not. It's Irish.
But I like you guys.
Thank you. They're probably two of the nicest guys I've ever met. The most polite, most willing to try anything, go for it. Just great. But were they to stand still and just sing, I'm not sure that we would love them just the same.
Thanks, lads.
See you later.
Thanks, see you later.
Yes, despite their questionable singing and their uniquely coiffed quiffs, Louis put them through to the live finals. And the world went Jedward mad. We couldn't get enough of them.
The reason why they stayed in that competition towards the end is because they were so entertaining. But in the end, even Simon, everyone liked him, didn't they? All the judges liked him. You can't help but like him. Love it or leave it, you better gain weight. You better
hit bulls out the king. The one thing that Jedward had was the ability to entertain. I mean, whether that came from the fact that they can't sing or dance or rap is open to question, but people are only watching that series to see what Jedward would come up with next.
By the time Jedward were voted off the X Factor, they were so popular, they made the 10 o'clock news.
The 18-year-old twins said today they were up for any challenge. So what next, then, for Jedward?
Everybody is looking for Jedward. Everybody, all sorts of people, for endorsements for hair, modelling, TV, radio, magazines. I mean, even talk of Jedward dolls.
I'm not surprised that Jedward was successful after X Factor because kids loved him, you know, and kids are the people who spend money these days, so you could argue that Simon Cowell knew that all along, but then that'd make him a cynical old man.
And now, Wrong Girl wins West End Role Shock. Well, shocking to the judges anyway.
I actually never thought I'd ever get through. I was the oldest. I was the fattest. I had it all going against me.
Jodie Pringer. I can see you in that pub in the East End. You are my perfect Nancy.
Jodie captured the hearts of the people.
You could be Nancy.
Oh, really?
She was loud. She was very northern.
Come here, you're gorgeous.
Extremely warm, genuine.
She had a great sense of humour.
You are lonely.
But despite all this, there was one very important person who didn't seem entirely convinced.
Jessie, that was extraordinary. Jodie, you have to, when you're thinking about theatre, think about what it's going to be night after night. It's got to be safe.
I think people thought that Andrew wanted Jessie to win and not necessarily wanting Jodie to win.
But the winning Nancy is Jodie!
I couldn't actually contemplate what was just said. And when they called my name, I almost went dumbfounded. You might as well just shot me up 300 feet in the air and let me land back on the earth, because it was amazing.
When Jodie won the role of Nancy, I thought she was fantastic and completely deserved to be the winner. I didn't think the panel felt the same.
And you look over at Andrew and Cameron, look absolutely devastated.
Are you pleased with the results?
Yeah, the people's Nancy. That was always going to be the people's choice, I thought.
and he says, "The people have chosen." Underlined with, "But I hate her," obviously.
Cameron, are you happy?
I'm thrilled for Jodie.
And Cameron McIntosh clearly was producing the show. And he goes like that through, couldn't even bring himself to say he was happy.
The response was, "I'm very happy for Jodie." It wasn't, "I'm very happy."
Well done.
So you sort of got the feeling that the public chose a different person than the panel wanted. And I felt sorry for Jodie, but do you know what? Good on her, she won the role.
Hey, I didn't care. I got to sing the end song as long as he needs me. I'd not sung it in ages.
As long as he...
What meant more to me than anything is they both went to my mum and dad and said they'd make the right choice. And as long as my mum and dad were happy, I was really happy.
Jodie is your victor! Thank you and goodbye!
When scary, hairy chef Marco Pierre-White took charge of Hell's Kitchen, we expected fireworks.
I think when Marco Pierre-White took over, everyone thought, right, he's just picking up Gordon Ramsay's sloppies and that's it. But it was amazing what he did with Hell's Kitchen. He turned it into, like, a Godfather movie.
But when it got too hot in the kitchen, shockingly, it had nothing to do with him.
In a pub, we wouldn't speak to one another, really.
Oh, of course you wouldn't.
My God, when Jim Davidson decided to appear on Hell's Kitchen, even he didn't know how badly he was going to come across.
I did have people come to the passage go to me, "Are you OK?"
People have been in your passage?
At the pass.
Well, that argument was just a hissy fit waiting to happen, you know. When they booked those two, they thought, "Oh, I wonder what they'll talk about." And it was obvious what they were going to talk about.
Gay men, have a look.
What look? Do I have that look?
No, only when you put it on.
He just kept making snide remarks regarding me.
A lot of shirtlifters have the same face, don't they?
Don't say shirtlifters, that's really rude.
I don't care. It's a sort of a preen.
And this is, like, probably 2 weeks in, and I went, "Do you know what? I kind of wish you wouldn't say that around me. I find that offensive." He went, "Well, I'll say what I want." And I'm going, "Well, actually, no. If it offends one person, maybe you should kind of stop."
Oh, I'm an opinionated old f***er.
You're very opinionated.
Of course I am.
And, of course, when I sat down, he went, "Oh, open range." When you called me a shirtlifter tonight, was that personal?
No, I didn't call you a shirtlifter.
What did you say?
I said, "Why do shirtlifters have that certain look?" Go on, you play the old homophobic card, mate. You're a f***ing disgrace.
What?
I don't live in the world where saying shirtlifter's going to offend anyone. All my shirtlifter mates don't take offence to that. But now I'm mixing with people that do take offence to something I don't know that's going to offend. So I'm...
How can you say that to me? I'm sitting right beside you. I'm an equal to you, Jim, in everything we've ever done.
Sure, that's what gay stands for. Good as you. I know that.
To say, you know, as G-A-Y stands for as good as you, that's going to be offensive. I won't be as good as you, Jim. You know what? I'll be B-A-Y. I'll be better than you. And I went, that doesn't make sense. B-T-Y is better than you, not B-A-Y. And then when that was happening, my friends were going, "Yeah, oh, fuck, he's just lost the argument. He got it wrong." You say the most insulting things to me.
No, I think we should call
in
it
in my whole entire life.
Yeah, I think so too.
The most offensive person I've ever met in my whole entire life. My one regret would have been crying. But I think it was actually quite stressful. I'd never had anyone be homophobic or say things like that to me in all of my life.
I'd like you just to leave me alone. Okay.
When I interviewed him after the show, he was almost still in a bit of denial about what he'd done. His behaviour was intolerable. And actually, I'm just surprised that the TV producers let him continue as long as they did.
The nation was outraged, and Jim was asked to hang up his chef's whites and leave Hell's Kitchen.
He'd probably say that, you know, he's sticking by his principles and you can't change him, but most of the people just say he's an ignorant old... Can't say that word, can you?
I have met him since, and he did apologise, but no, I wish him the best in water under the bridge.
Jarvis Cocker, successful recording artist, coolest man in pop, went on Stars in Their Eyes.
Normally on Celebrity Stars in Their Eyes, you get the odd soap star or the odd fading rock star who wants to get their career back, but you don't get someone like Jarvis Cocker.
So, tell me a bit about the person you're going to be, Jarvis.
What's great about the Jarvis Cocker thing is that, you know, here is a musician with everything to lose. I was just completely in awe of the man.
And you'll never guess who the coolest man in pop performed as.
Well, he was born in Perth, Australia. He once boasted of having an extra appendage. And he did have a hit with a didgeridoo version of Stairway to Heaven.
Can you tell who it is yet?
Tonight, Matthew, I am going to be Rolf Harris.
Rolf Harris!
I can't believe the Jarvis Cocker went on. Stars in their eyes. Why?
I thought it was amazing because he was obviously doing it as some sort of performance art thing for all his arty mates down in Hoxton. But most people watching it would have just thought, what does he look like?
Two little boys had two little toys. Each had a wooden horse.
It was completely surreal. It was a fantastically bizarre, off-the-wall moment in TV.
Did you think I would leave you dying? There's room on my horse for two.
He even learned the stylophone.
It brought a lump to the throat, a tear to the eye. It was a genuinely moving performance.
Probably one of the most embarrassing auditions in reality TV history, easily.
Prepare yourselves. It's Darius Does Britney on Pop Stars.
Loneliness is killing me, and I must confess, I still believe.
I think one of the funniest things I have ever witnessed.
I remember being sat in the room just watching him thinking, what are you doing?
He was trying to impress so much that he picked every note under the sun to hit.
Lose my mind, give me a sign.
All you see is my head down writing because I was trying not to laugh so much.
Hit me one more time.
It's the little, like, oh, I love myself, that he gives. It's just phenomenal.
He was so sure he had done the most amazing performance. He literally is like, as he walks off, he claps his hands. It's like, I nailed that, and off he goes. And we were just like, what was he thinking? That has to be just one of the worst auditions we have ever, ever seen.
Coming up, a comedy favourite as you've never seen him before.
But he was being so serious about it.
And a politician takes to the dance floor.
And then suddenly it all went wrong.
Welcome back to the 50 most shocking talent show moments.
Oh, he's stuck.
And just when we think there's nothing left to shock us...
Oh, Christ.
Along comes this.
Do you ever know that you're my hero?
At number 7, a very young Nadine Coyle auditioning for Irish pop stars.
We want to see you.
There's nothing that girl will not do to get in the band.
The band that Nadine was so keen to be part of was this tele-talent show-created group called Six. Can you spot the deliberate mistake? That's right, there's only 5 of them. And it's not because 6 can't count to 6, it's because Nadine was fired from the band. And this is why.
You needed to be 18 years old to be in the band. Nadine was only 16.
Which came to light when Nadine slipped up in an interview.
I'm from Lurkill and Derry. Date of birth 15th of the 6th, 85. Make me a Gemini. What's the birthday
say tonight? 15th of
Oops. Somebody came into the room, they said, listen, Nadine has slipped up. She said something in an interview where she gave the wrong date of birth. And I turned around to Nadine and went, God, Nadine, we thought you were a child. At which point she burst out crying and ran out of the room.
But the porky pies didn't stop there.
Mama, did you give me my passport whenever we...
Nadine phones home looking for her mislaid passport.
And then I